Hello, boys and girls. I'm your Peter Pan storyteller.
This is the story of the last starfighter.
This is the story of Gremlins.
This is the story of Tron.
This is the story of Raiders of the Lost Ark.
This is the story of the Empire Strikes Back.
You can read along with me in your book.
You can follow the story along with me.
Every time you hear this sound.
Every time you hear this sound.
Turn the pages when you hear this sound.
You will know it is time to turn the page when you hear the computer sound like this.
Let's begin. Now.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the latest episode of When You Hear This Sound, brought to you by the Space Monkey X Audio Workshop. This is your host, Rob Lamley. The Man of Steel is back in the news as James Gunn prepares his upcoming Superman film, so I thought it might be a good time for us to visit an adventure from Superman's past, City Under Siege, from Peter Pan Records. Superman is the creation of writer Jerry Siegel and illustrator Joe Shuster, who first introduced the character in Action Comics No. 1, published in April of 1938. The character has become synonymous with superheroes, essentially creating the genre as we know it, and is now an endearing pop culture icon known all over the world. The story I have for you today, City Under Siege, was released in 1978 along with three other Superman adventures, The Man from Krypton, Star of Bangalore, and The Killer Bees. Two of these stories, The Man from Krypton and City Under Siege, were also released as read-along comic books. I don't own the comic book version, but I have found the book online, so I'll put a link to it in the show notes over at spacemonkeyx.net. Normally, it would be very difficult to track down who was responsible for these kids' record adventures, but in this case, Peter Pan clearly states that Bill Wells wrote the script for these Superman stories. Unfortunately, with a name like that, I couldn't find out any more about him or his other work. However, while they don't get credit in the read-along comic book, thanks to some internet sleuthing, I've discovered that the artwork for the comic was created by Ross Andrew, with inks by Dick Giordano. Andrew started his comic book career working on the long-running Tarzan comic strip in 1948. The strip ended just a few years later, so Andrew teamed up with his friend and inker, Mike Esposito, to create their own comic book company. Then, in 1953, the two started drawing war comics for DC under titles like All-American Men of War, Star-Spangled War Stories, and G.I. Combat. In 1958, Andrew began working on Wonder Woman and essentially reinvented the character for the Silver Age. By the early 1970s, Andrew left DC and moved to Marvel, where he would go on to have a 5-year stint as the penciler for The Amazing Spider-Man, during some of the character's most formative years. During his tenure on Spider-Man, Andrew, along with Jerry Conway and artist John Romita, introduced the Punisher in 1973. Then in 1976, Andrew penciled the first intercompany crossover comic, Superman vs. The Amazing Spider-Man, written by Jerry Conway. Around the same time that he drew City Under Siege, Andrew returned to DC, where he teamed up with inker Dick Giordano, and the two became the primary cover artists for DC throughout the 1980s. Unfortunately, Andrew passed away in 1993 while he was working on a comic called The Strobe Warrior with longtime collaborator Esposito. He was inducted into the Will Eisner Comic Book Hall of Fame in 2007. Dick Giordano started his comic book career in 1952 at Charlton Comics, developing their Western and superhero comics until 1968 when he left to become an editor at DC. However, after only a few years, Giordano left DC to work for Neil Adams Continuity Comic Studio, which handled the artwork on many read-along record books for Peter Pan. It was during this time that Giordano would have worked on the City Under Siege comic with Andrew. Giordano would later go on to ink the Superman vs. The Amazing Spider-Man crossover comic with Andrew, as well as ink the famous one-shot comic Superman vs. Muhammad Ali. Giordano went back to DC in 1981 and worked there until 1993 when he returned to freelance work. His last mainstream appearance was in Jonah Hex Volume 2, No. 51, published in 2010, shortly before his death from leukemia. Since 2010, the Hero Initiative has given out an award in his honor to those in the comic book industry who show generosity and integrity in support of the comic book community. Long story short, check out the comic book with this story. It's pretty great. And with that, let's get to the record. Here is Superman, City Under Siege, released in 1978 by Peter Pan Records. Enjoy.
Thank you. Far out at sea, 200 miles from the nearest land, a small fishing boat bobs on the ocean swell. There is no one aboard. All is silence except for an ominous ticking below deck. Ticking off the hours, the minutes, the seconds, until... blinding light fills the sky, brighter than the sun. A towering black cloud like a huge mushroom blooms upward into the heavens. Giant tidal waves form in the waters and rush landward. Thousands of miles away, in the city room of the Daily Planet in Metropolis, the presses are stopped.
Copy.
Joey, hold that lead on the president. Bullet coming in.
You got the mayor's office on the phone yet?
I ain't even had lunch.
Copy.
City desk. What? Lady, an atomic bomb just went off. We don't have time to rescue cats from trees. Call the SPCA. City desk. No, as far as you know, there were no casualties. That's right. Washington says it was probably a small bomb. 5-10 kilotons. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Lois, where's Kent?
Fishing.
What?
No kidding. He's up in Minnesota with Jimmy Olsen.
What a time to pick to go fishing. Get him back.
I'll try. Daily Planet, Lois Lane.
Listen, lady, and listen good. The bomb we triggered in the ocean was a baby. A mere 4 kilotons. The next one will be over 100.
Who is this?
Never mind. Just listen. We want $10 billion. $10 billion in gold. It will be placed aboard a 747 jet airplane, fully fueled in Gander. We will give further instructions at that point in time.
Who's we? Who are you?
We are Force One. Unless the gold is placed at our disposal by noon tomorrow, your charming city of Metropolis will be reduced to rubble.
Is this a joke?
You may treat it as a joke if you wish. The 12 noon tomorrow is reality time. By the way, 100 kilotons isn't bad for a homemade bomb, huh?
Hello? Hello? Hello?
In the mayor's office at City Hall, Lois tells her story to city officials, scientists, members of the FBI and CIA.
Could this be a hoax?
We just can't take the chance. Not in the light of that explosion at sea.
It's 5 o'clock now. That leaves us 17 hours to find the bomb.
Sure, but how?
What do you think, Mr. Mayor?
Frankly, I think we only have one hope. Superman. Can we contact him, Lois?
Clark Kent might.
Where is Clark?
On vacation, Mr. Mayor, with Jimmy Olsen, at a fishing camp up in the Minnesota wilderness. I placed a call, but so far no connection.
I hate to be a wet blanket, but we now have 16 hours, 59 minutes, and 30 seconds.
At that moment, in an abandoned warehouse in downtown Metropolis, three people sit in the rear of a trailer truck. Two of them are hunched over a large mass of metal and wire. The third, a man with a scar running from left eyebrow to chin, looks on.
Hey, cool it, man. That thing's supposed to go off at noon tomorrow, and I'd rather not be around.
That's what I'm working on. The timer. Ah, there. Okay, let's try it.
Try what?
The moment of truth, sweetheart. See this lever here? I move it this way, you know. After that, either the timing mechanism starts, or the mass becomes critical, and we all go up in atoms. Right, Trask?
Well put, young man.
Wait a minute. Can't we get away from here? Do it by remote control?
Jenny, darling, we'd have to be 300 miles from here, which we will be if the timer works. Go ahead, Randy. It's your baby. Well done, friend. Well done.
Call me Einstein.
Now let's split this town.
In time, Jenny, in time. Our plane is at the airport. First, we drive our little firecracker to ground zero, directly to the center of Metropolis.
What about the gold?
Don't worry. We'll get it. They'll follow my instructions.
Seconds into minutes, minutes into hours, the time passes as Metropolis sleeps. In the very center of the city, beneath an old railroad bridge, stands the truck, its cargo ticking toward death. At the Daily Planet, the sweep hands of the electric clocks move silently.
Lois Lane?
Ready with that Michigan call.
Hello?
Rainbow Lodge.
Is Clark Kent there?
Hello?
Is Clark Kent there?
I can't hear you.
Clark Kent, is he there?
Oh, yeah, that fishing fella. He was. He ain't now.
Where is he? It's very important.
Well, now, him and that other fishing fella. What's his name?
Jimmy Olsen?
Yep, that's him. Anyways, they took off.
Took off?
Rented one of them light planes they did. Fishing weren't no good down here. Went north.
Where north?
Well, near as I can figure, I'd say maybe 200 miles up to the Quetico Superior area.
Can they be reached?
Ma'am, there ain't no folks up there. Not to speak of. Just fish.
5 o'clock, Mr. Mayor. 7 hours to Holocaust.
There must be some way to reach Kent.
In the dark? 200 miles into nowhere? How?
I've got an idea. It's a long shot, and we'll have to wait until it's light.
Dawn breaks over northern Minnesota. Waist high in the rippling waters of a gently flowing stream, Clark Kent and Jimmy Olsen cast for trout. The sky brightens.
Hey, Clark.
You got a strike?
No, look at that.
What?
That plane. He's skywriting.
Skywriting? Out here? Ridiculous.
That's what I was thinking. What's to advertise around here? There's no people.
It can't be fish bait.
He's coming this way.
There he goes again.
A-B-O-M-B.
Clark and Jimmy watch the letters appear in the sky, slowly, one by one, until...
A-bomb. Metropolis. Get Superman. Lois. Jimmy, let's go.
Clark!
I twisted my ankle. Maybe broke.
Grab my shoulder.
No.
Come on.
No, you get back to the Rainbow Lodge. Just get me to the shore and you get back to the lodge. Call this number, 516-9206 in Metropolis. Superman will answer. Tell him what goes.
Clark, I can't leave you here.
Don't argue, Jimmy. Do it. We're fighting time. Make the call and get back to Metropolis. Send the plane back for me. Now get moving.
Leaving Clark Kent on the shore of the stream, Jimmy Olsen charges towards the seaplane and takes off. As the plane scuds across the lake, Clark Kent watches it rise into the sky and disappear over the trees. Moments later, he emerges from the tent as Superman and zooms upward. Streaks towards Metropolis at fantastic speed, and within 2 minutes stands in the mayor's office in City Hall.
All right, quiet, please, quiet. The bomb is set for noon, Superman.
That gives us less than 5 hours.
And we have no idea what part of the city they placed it.
Hold it. One question. Does that bomb emit radiation?
Yes, it does.
Okay, there's our hope. Wish me luck.
Look at that!
Right out the window.
Amazing!
He'll find it.
Rocketing upward, Superman speeds to the Metropolis Geological Laboratory, picks up an ultra-sensitive Geiger counter, and then zooms into the skies above the city.
There's something. Let's check it out.
Superman dives down at tremendous speed.
Small private hospital. Could the bomb be in there? Well, we'll find out with my X-ray vision. Radioactive tracer material. The patient may live, but not unless I find that bomb.
Blasting skyward again, Superman circles over Metropolis. Another hospital brings him to Earth, then a government laboratory. But the bomb still eludes him.
11:40. 20 minutes to go and no sign. Nothing. Listen to that. Maybe this time. Seems to be coming from that old railroad bridge. It's the bomb inside that trailer truck. Gotta move fast. This is it, all right. But bolted down and just 15 minutes to go. No sense trying to pry it loose.
Stepping outside, he picks up the entire trailer truck and takes to the skies. Traveling at a rate approaching the speed of light, Superman races toward the sun. 1 million miles from the blazing star, Superman screeches to a halt. And rears back and hurls the bomb straight into its center.
Strike one for you, Force One. The other two come later.
Exploding within our great sun, the homemade A-bomb is a mere puffball. The sky brightens only slightly, and on Earth a few sunspots are recorded, for nothing that man can make is mightier than the forces of the universe. Later, in the city room at the planet.
Well, look who's here. Clark Kent, cub reporter.
Why the sarcasm?
I don't blame him. Where were you when the bomb hit the sun?
I almost broke my ankle in that stream.
You don't seem to be limping.
Well, it healed.
I sometimes wonder about you.
Why?
You're never here when Superman saves the day. You must have a block.
What about that terrorist group? I read about it on the way from Minnesota.
The FBI finally got a line on them. Force One, they called themselves. Two men and a girl. They were picked up trying to board a plane at the airport.
It's a nice feeling, isn't it, to have the FBI around?
And, of course, Superman.
Thanks for stopping by the show today. Be sure to subscribe on iTunes, Spotify, or your favorite podcast app. You can head over to spacemonkeyx.net for pictures, links, and additional information about this episode, and check out some of the other podcasts presented by the Space Monkey X Audio Workshop. This has been your host, Rob Lamley. Thanks for listening to When You Hear This Sound, the podcast dedicated to the weird and wonderful world of read-along record books and storybook vinyl. I'll see y'all next time.